Good morning. Welcome. Good morning. I'm Jim Langbartels, retired pastor living in Greenfield. May the Lord bless our worship this morning. We'll begin with the first hymn. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you.
And also with you.
We have come into the presence of God who created us to love and to serve Him as His dear children. But we have disobeyed Him and deserve only His wrath and punishment. Therefore, let us confess our sins and plead for His mercy.
Merciful Father in heaven, I am altogether sinful from birth. In countless ways I have sinned against you, and do not deserve to be called your child. But trusting in Jesus, my Savior, I pray, have mercy on me according to your unfailing love. Cleanse me from my sin, and take away my guilt.
God, our Heavenly Father, has forgiven all your sins. By the perfect life and innocent death of our Lord Jesus Christ, He has removed your guilt forever. You are His own dear child. May God give you strength to live according to His will.
Amen.
In the peace of forgiveness, let us praise the Lord. Almighty and everlasting God, give us an increase of faith, hope, and love. And that we may obtain what you promise, make us love what you command. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Our first scripture reading this morning, which also serves as our sermon text, is from the Old Testament book of Judges, chapter 7, verses 1 through 8. Early in the morning, Jerubbaal, that is Gideon, and all his men camped at the spring of Harod. The camp of Midian was north of them, in the valley near the hill of Moreh. The Lord said to Gideon, "You have too many men. I cannot deliver Midian into their hands, or Israel would boast against me. My own strength has saved me. Now announce to the army, anyone who trembles with fear may turn back and leave Mount Gilead." So 22,000 men left, while 10,000 remained. But the Lord said to Gideon, "There are still too many men. Take them down to the water, and I will thin them out for you there. If I say, 'This one shall go with you,' he shall go. But if I say, 'This one shall not go with you,' he shall not go." So Gideon took the men down to the water. There the Lord told him, "Separate those who lap the water with their tongues as a dog laps from those who kneel down to drink." 300 of them drank from cupped hands lapping like dogs. All the rest got down on their knees to drink. The Lord said to Gideon, "With the 300 men that lapped, I will save you and give the Midianites into your hands. Let all the others go home." We'll join in singing Psalm 72.
Thank you.
second scripture reading is from the Apostle Paul's letter to the Romans, chapter 9, verses 1 through 9. I speak the truth in Christ. I am not lying. My conscience confirms it through the Holy Spirit. I have great sorrow and unceasing anguish in my heart. For I could wish that I myself were cursed and cut off from Christ for the sake of my people, those of my own race, the people of Israel. Theirs is the adoption to sonship. Theirs the divine glory, the covenants, the receiving of the law, the temple worship, and the promises. Theirs are the patriarchs, and from them is traced the human ancestry of the Messiah, who is God over all, forever praised. Amen. It is not as though God's word had failed. For not all who are descended from Israel are Israel, nor because they are his descendants are they all Abraham's children. On the contrary, it is through Isaac that your offspring will be reckoned. In other words, it is not the children by physical descent who are God's children, but it is the children of the promise who are regarded as Abraham's offspring. For this was how the promise was stated: at the appointed time, I will return, and Sarah will have a son. This is the word of the Lord. Is written in the Gospel according to St. Luke, chapter 13, beginning with the 22nd verse. Then Jesus went through the towns and villages, teaching as he made his way to Jerusalem. Someone asked him, Lord, are only a few people going to be saved? He said to them, make every effort to enter through the narrow door. Because many, I tell you, will try to enter and will not be able to. Once the owner of the house gets up and closes the door, you will stand outside knocking and pleading, Sir, open the door for us. But he will answer, I don't know you or where you come from. Then you will say, We ate and drank with you, and you taught in our streets. But he will reply, I don't know you or where you come from. Away from me, all you evildoers. There will be weeping there and gnashing of teeth when you see Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and all the prophets in the kingdom of God, but you yourselves thrown out. People will come from east and west and north and south, and will take their places at the feast in the kingdom of God. Indeed, there are those who are last who will be first, and first who will be last. The Gospel of the Lord.
Thank you.
Grace to you and peace from God our Father, from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. So it's time to buy a new car. You find that you have $32,000 available. That's not how much you're authorized to borrow, but how much you've managed to save up and are ready to expend on this purchase. Things are looking pretty good. And then God comes to you and tells you that you have too much money to buy that new car. If you buy that car with $32,000, you're going to think that you bought the car and don't need to rely on God at all. So he tells you to give away $22,000. And you obey. Now you have $10,000 to buy a new car, which will make a nice down payment on that new car. But God speaks to you again and tells you that you have too much money to buy that car. You'll think about how you worked hard and earned all that money, and you can spend it any way you want, and you won't rely on him. So he tells you to give away $9,700 of that money. And you obey. Now you set off to buy your new car with the $300 remaining. Can you imagine something like that happening? It just doesn't seem very realistic at all. We can leave out of the picture how it is that God might come and talk to you that way, but if he did, we just have to think this does not make sense. Fortunately, God does not come to us and tell us to give away our money in that way. Or maybe, unfortunately, God doesn't come to us and tell us to give away that money we might want to trust in that way. We want to look this morning at the dilemma that Gideon was facing and see if perhaps we can learn something of the lesson that God taught to Gideon. The time of the judges was a very confused period in Israel's history, a time when everyone did as he saw fit, not completely unlike today. There was a recurring pattern during these years in between the death of Joshua, who had led the Israelites into the Promised Land, and the time when Israel got its first kings in Saul, David, and Solomon. In those in-between centuries, the Israelites would first forget about the Lord. The Lord would second send some foreign nation to oppress them. Third, the Israelites would cry out to the Lord for help. And fourth, the Lord would raise up a judge, a leader, to deliver them from their enemy. Gideon, the judge, was far from perfect before he became a judge, far from perfect afterwards, and wasn't all that great as a judge. And we're not perfect people either, so perhaps we can learn something from him. The foreign nation the Lord sent this time against the Israelites was the Midianites. It worked in this way. Each year the Israelites would plant their crops, and then each year the Midianites would come and take whatever they wanted and destroy the rest. Soon, the Israelites were impoverished. The result was famine. Many Bible students suggest that this was the time when Naomi's family left Israel and lived in Moab for about 10 years, and Ruth, the Moabitess, entered Naomi's family and into the family line, the family tree of the Savior. The Israelites couldn't fight against the Midianites because there were too many of them. The book of Judges says that it was impossible to count the men of Midian. When the Israelites cried out for help, God sent them the judge Gideon. God told Gideon, "Go in the strength you have and save Israel out of Midian's hand. Am I not sending you?" That should have been enough for Gideon. He had the Lord's own words specifically telling him what to do. Gideon did not let that be enough. Gideon doubted the Lord. Gideon asked for special signs to convince him it really was the Lord. Gideon put a fleece outside and told the Lord, "Put dew on that fleece tonight, but nothing around it." And the next night, to be certain, he put that fleece out there again and said, "This time no dew on the fleece, but around the fleece." And the Lord graciously granted those miraculous signs for Gideon. And now he was sort of convinced that he should go ahead with this. Gideon summoned the Israelites' army to help him, and 32,000 soldiers showed up. That still was probably less than the number of Midianites, but they would have a chance. But the Lord spoke to Gideon, "You have too many men for me to deliver Midian into their hands. In order that Israel may not boast against me that her own strength has saved her, announce now to the people, anyone who trembles with fear may turn back and leave Mount Gilead." The Israelite soldiers were already outnumbered, but the Lord saw the need to thin them down somewhat. "Anyone who trembles with fear may turn back." War is a dangerous business. After all, the enemy soldiers have the goal of killing you. It is kill or be killed. Success in battle depends somewhat on your strength and your skill and your training, but there is also much uncertainty and risk involved. After all, bombs make no distinction between soldiers who are well trained and soldiers who are poorly trained. Anyone who does not tremble with a healthy fear before battle is not properly prepared for what's going to happen. When Gideon invited those who trembled with fear to leave, 22,000 soldiers did leave, and only 10,000 soldiers remained. 10,000 soldiers who said that they were not afraid and so probably didn't understand what was going to happen. I'm suggesting that Gideon was left with the 10,000 worst soldiers and the 22,000 best soldiers had left. These 10,000 foolishly were not afraid. Yet the Lord was not stacking the odds in Gideon's favor. But more, the Lord spoke to Gideon again. "There are still too many men. Take them down to the water, and I will sift them for you there. If I say this one shall go with you, he shall go. But if I say this one shall not go with you, he shall not go." The 10,000 soldiers were sent down to the water to drink, as depicted on the front of the bulletin. Some of the soldiers went down on one knee and scooped up water with their hand so they could keep their sword in the other hand and keep their eyes peered for the enemy. Some of the soldiers flopped down on their bellies and lapped up water like a dog, completely vulnerable to the enemy. There were 9,700 soldiers who went down on one knee and 300 soldiers who went down on their bellies. And the Lord sent the 9,700 soldiers home, leaving only those 300 soldiers who foolishly were not afraid and who foolishly kept no watch for the enemy. What would you have been thinking if you had been Gideon? This is kind of a hopeless situation. Whereas the 32,000 soldiers might have had a chance, those 300 soldiers had nothing but a prayer. The Lord had taken a bad situation and made it worse twice. even if you know how the story ends. Consider for a moment how similar our lives sometimes are to the situation that Gideon was in. We can ask questions of the Lord that really indicate that we're trying to trust in ourselves or in things rather than relying on the Lord. Why doesn't the Lord just do an amazing miracle and make everyone believe in him? Why doesn't he show everybody that he exists so they wouldn't have any doubt about that? Since the Lord is all-powerful, why does he make us work so hard? Why doesn't he just supply us with everything that we need? Questions like that and the answers to those questions point to our need to rely on the Lord for all things, not on these things. Why doesn't God do amazing miracles so that everyone has to believe in him? The obvious answer is that the Lord has done amazing miracles. And some people believe the amazing miracles Jesus performed, but it seems more often that they refused to believe in spite of the evidence in front of their eyes. Jesus' perhaps most amazing miracle of all, raising Lazarus to life again 4 days after he died, that miracle led to an increase in the plots to kill Jesus. It was right after that the high priest Caiaphas pronounced the death sentence on Jesus. He said, "It is better for you that one man, Jesus, died for the people than that the whole nation perish." If God is all-powerful, why does he make us work so hard? Even in the Garden of Eden, before the fall into sin, when Adam and Eve and everything was still perfect, God gave Adam and Eve useful work to do in caring for the garden, which probably didn't need much care. We too need something useful to do to give meaning to our lives. This Lord especially lets us pray something useful. Why doesn't God just supply all of our needs without our having to work for them? Well, the Lord recognizes that it is more important for us to have the proper attitude toward him than it is for us to have all the things that we might think that we need. The Lord teaches Gideon to rely on God's promises, not on human strength. That's a valuable lesson for us as well. We can rely on God's promises even when human strength fails. Even more than those lessons, we need to have the proper attitude toward the God who gives us eternal life. Just as Gideon needed to learn not to rely on those 32,000 soldiers for victory, so we need to learn to not to rely on how good we think we are for heaven. Rather, we need to rely on God's promise that he has done everything for us and that he gives us full forgiveness in Jesus. Nothing we do will merit anything for us, but only what Jesus has already done for us. Our doing is important, not to earn something from God, but to thank him for what he has already given to us. That night, the Midianite soldiers were all camped in a valley, and Gideon stationed his 300 soldiers on the hillside around that valley. Not one of those 300 soldiers was armed with a sword or a spear or a shield. Instead, each of them was armed with a trumpet, a ram's horn, and a torch inside a jar. At the signal from Gideon, each of those 300 soldiers blew their horn and revealed their trumpet and shouted, "A sword for the Lord and for Gideon." The Lord struck the Midianites with terror. They thought that they were surrounded by 300 companies of soldiers instead of by 300 incompetents. Some of the Midianites turned on each other and killed each other. The survivors fled. The Israelites pursued. The Midianites were routed. The Israelites were victorious. God does not command us to give away our money in those strange ways. He does command us to trust in Him. It is a good thing for us when the Lord presents us with some of the difficulties that Gideon faced. It is good for us when the Lord takes away the things that we would rely on and leaves us nothing to rely on except Him. After all, our own strength will never save us. Our own wisdom will never save us. Our own wealth will never save us. The Lord can dispense with our strength and our wisdom and our wealth anytime He wishes, and He has often done so. And then we are forced to trust in Him. Learn the lesson that the Lord taught Gideon. It is always better to learn from other people's mistakes, lest we have to learn from our own mistakes. Trust in the Lord completely and let Him do all of the hard work. We can just do the simple things that He gives us to do. When the Lord does see that it's necessary to teach us something the hard way by taking away what we rely on, let us be quick learners and trust in Him all the more. Amen. May the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Amen. We join in confessing our faith according to the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to hell. The third day He rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there He will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. O Lord our God, you are wise and powerful, good and gracious. Your mercies are new every morning. Each day you open your hand and provide for the needs of your children on earth. Strengthen your church in all the world. Let your comforting message of salvation in Christ Jesus be proclaimed to troubled souls everywhere.
These are ministries and offerings to extend your kingdom and your hope.
We bring you our requests for the various structures of our society. Bless our national, state, and local governments. Grant prosperity to our businesses and industries. Give employers a sense of fairness toward their workers and employees a feeling of joy and pride in their workmanship.
Help us find satisfaction in all work well done.
Invigorate the schools of our land. Give success to every effort that helps students read, think, and communicate in ways that will promote an informed and responsible citizenry. Arouse curious minds to discover the wonders of your created order.
Give us teachers and students who pursue excellence.
Strengthen the families of our country. Give fathers and mothers a renewed commitment to be good parents. Give children and young people the wisdom to regard their parents as your representatives. Hear us, Lord, as we bring you our private petitions. Gracious Father, we pray boldly as Jesus taught, with the confidence that you will hear, and with the faith that you will respond for our welfare.
Amen.
Our Father, who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Thank you. O Lord God, our Heavenly Father, pour out the Holy Spirit on your faithful people. Keep us strong in your grace and truth. Protect and comfort us in all temptation, and bestow on us your saving peace. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Brothers and sisters, go in peace. Live in harmony with one another. Serve the Lord with gladness. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with favor and give you peace.